This will be the content that we'll be covering today. We're going to go through the Xiongnu Civil War, how the Xiongnu Empire broke apart because of the disagreement within. And because of that, they weakened and they have to submit to the Chinese Empire. We're going to see how the Xiongnu state falls under the tributary system of China, and we're going to find out a bit more what this system is all about. And then later on, we will explore what is the complications of the relationship between Xiongnu and China after they formally surrendered to China. And then we will be looking also at what are the good and the bad of having the Xiongnu being a defense force for China, which we will talk about later on. To give you the historical background and the context, what we are looking at today is the Han dynasty. Okay, and these are the dynasties of China history leading up to the leading up to the Han dynasties. So you have the Xia dynasty first, you have the Shang, you have the Zhou, and then you have the first unified Qin, as the Qin Shi Huang. After Qin, you have the former Han and the later Han. So these are the periods that we are focusing on for today. Let's set the background first. For those of you who might have missed the first part of the talk, in the first part, what we covered was the complication of the relationship between the Xiongnu Confederacy and the Han Empire. The Xiongnu is not one whole homogeneous tribe, but it's made of different tribes, perhaps with different languages or different culture, but all of them submit to one main leader, which is the Xiongnu, because the Xiongnu was military-wise was powerful enough to make the other tribes submit to them. And these tribes, they all are settled in the area of the Mongolia desert area, modern-day Mongolia area. And after the Xiongnu tribe managed to overpower the other tribes and unite them into one confederacy, they launched a massive campaign against the Chinese Empire. And why was that so? Because the terrain and the living condition of the Mongolian desert area was not conducive for good agricultural produce. And often they have difficulties in getting enough resources and supplies. With the lack of resources and supplies, they have no choice but to raid the next neighbors around there that are rich. So what are the neighbors? China was one of them. And China was not the only one that the Xiongnu would raid from. They would also raid from areas of western region, which is Siyu. So these areas are the rich areas which the Xiongnu people get their supplies and goods from. And the aggression of the Xiongnu was so great, and the Chinese Empire don't really have a good solution to offer. They came up with this peacemaking policy where China offered gifts and princesses to the Xiongnu chieftains, the Xiongnu Chanri. This was a peacemaking policy where the Chinese Empire tried to engage so much military-wise with the Xiongnu, but it did not work out. Despite receiving the gifts and the princesses, the Xiongnu tribes still have once in a while intrusions into the Chinese Empire. So Han Wudi realized that enough is enough. I don't think I will be able to take this nonsense anymore, and he switched his policy into an aggressive one, where he proactively ordered his army to go into the Xiongnu terrain to attack them. But the Xiongnus, they are very smart. They are able to make use of the terrain to their advantage, because the desert is so huge and so boundless that In fact, the living habits of the Xiongnu is also such that they move around a lot. They don't have a city. Compared to China, in relative wise, China will be at disadvantage because you have a fixed capital. So once you hit the capital, that's it, the empire is affected. But the Xiongnu people don't have a fixed capital. They move all over the place. So it's very difficult to track them down and really have an effective military action against them. In the end, the war appeared. In the end, the war had exhausted the Han Empire's resources. It was not effective at all to totally control the Xiongnu. The war ended as a stalemate. There was no conclusive win or victory at the end of this war. And the Han Empire subsequently, after the Han Wudi, realized that this is not a good way to go, and they put a stop to the military campaigns. This is the historical background of this period. And now we are looking at post-Wudi. What happens after the emperors of the Han Wudi? During this time, it happens so that the Xiongnu themselves were weakened by internal problems. What are some of the internal problems? Succession problems. The son is supposed to take over as the next Chanyu. Chanyu is something like an emperor for the Xiongnu Empire. But they don't agree. They decided to set another successor, or other local prince are not willing to listen to the main Chanyu, and they fought among themselves. At this point of time, the Xiongnu were weakened by their own internal struggles. This was a different situation under the previous Chanyu during the Han Wudi times, where the Xiongnu confederacy were quite united and they fought as one. But here we see that there are a lot of internal issues that lead to them to start to break apart. So the Xiongnu Empire were not as strong as before, and they resorted to their shrewdness to their relationship between the Han Empire. What they do is that at one moment they would say to the Han Emperor that we will make peace with you, and once the Han Empire relaxed on their defense, the Xiongnu will attack them. And when the Han Emperor wants to attack them, the Xiongnu say, "I'm sorry, I did not intentionally attack you just now. I'm sorry. Can we make peace again?" So that was the relationship, alternating between peace and raiding. And the Xiongnu also went ahead to attack Chinese foreign allies such as the Wusun. Wusun is another kind of tribe. Okay, and the Xiongnu was in a tussle with China over the control of Western region during this period of time. And what was the Chinese Empire doing at this point of time? No more wars. Wars are too expensive for us. We better have a break. And the Chinese Empire tried not to fight, if possible, unless really threatened. There are also actually instances where the Chinese allies were attacked. I don't know, but the Chinese people don't do anything about it. Okay? Unless it was really necessary. Generally speaking, the Han's military actions were more defensive rather than offensive. It's more to safeguard their own interests than to go ahead to colonize the Xiongnu or to seize terrain from the Xiongnu. So with all the internal struggles, it started to build up and build up until a serious civil war broke out in the 59 BC. So the Chanyu in Lu passed away, and several other chieftains think that they have the right to succeed as the next Chanyu. They couldn't agree to who should succeed next, and they fought against each other. And out of so many chieftains, right, one of the main ones would be this person here, Wu Han Ye. So Wu Han Ye decided that I can't fight all these other Xiongnu tribes by myself, I realized that during the Han Wudi time, the Han Wudi's time, the Chinese military force was very strong. They were able to attack us and force us to retreat further north. And I think the Chinese Empire makes a very good military ally. So with that in mind, he ran and approached the Chinese court and offered to surrender to the Han Empire. But that comes with a condition. What he really wanted and needed was military aid from the Han Empire, and that was given to him. In exchange for this Chinese military support, there are a few conditions for him to fulfill on his end. One is that this begins the system of the tributary system of the Han Chinese. What this means is that there is a symbolic exchange of gifts and goods from two different countries. So the Xiongnu has to send an ambassador, maybe the Chinese himself or somebody, to the Chinese court, pay respect to the emperor, and offer some unique produce from his country over to the Han Empire, the Han Emperor. And in exchange, after receiving the gift from this diplomat, the Han Emperor is obligated to return something in exchange. So it's not just taking only, but it's an exchange of goods. And to the Chinese eyes, this is viewed as a sign of submission and respect when this is being done. And one other condition is that since you have seen yourself as a tribute state under me, you show respect to me, I have some kind of influence over you, you have to send your prince over as a hostage. And you, with that hostage in my hand, I have influence over you, you can't rebel against me because I have your successor with me. That's like a sort of a threat where you have your internal family member with the enemy and you can't do anything funny. Because if you do something funny, he's gonna kill your family member. Okay? So what caused the Xiongnu Empire to weaken? It lies with the very structure of the Xiongnu people itself. You see, for the Xiongnu Empire, it's not like the Han Chinese Empire where you have the emperor with a lot of control and power over his subjects. But rather, the Xiongnu Empire is a confederacy, which is made of different tribes. And each tribe has a tribe's leader who still had an amount of power and influence over his own subjects. So he's like a king on the top with several other small kings below him. And with that means that when the king on the top weakens, right, all these small kings still have their power. And when the occasion arises, they have the chance and opportunity to rise, to stage an uprise and seize power for themselves. Okay, this is the kind of political structure you have in the Xiongnu Empire. And also to divide the power equally, the Xiongnu adopted this system of a left and a right equivalent of a post. Give you an example, in the Han Chinese political system, you have a left prime minister and a right prime minister. Okay, so for the Xiongnu, they also have something like that, a left king and a right king to spread out the power. This is an attempt to weaken the power of the kings, so that the power is shared between two kings. But this has its good and its bad. It means that there's more people who can contend for power. After the weakening of the Xiongnu Confederacy due to internal problems, they realized that they have no choice but to turn to the Chinese. And what was their thought at that point of time? So the Xiongnu king claimed, according to the records of Han Shu, Han's power is now at its peak. Wu Sun and other walled states have all become China's vassals. By contrast, we Xiongnu have been declining in power since the days of the Cang Yu, Xu Di Hou, and there is no way for us to restore our fallen fortunes. In spite of all our exertions, we have experienced scarcely a single day of tranquility. At present, our very security depends upon whether we submit to Han or not. What better course is there for us to follow? And this seems to describe the Xiongnu in a very desperate plight. Like, they have no choice but to submit to Han. But let me just remind you that this is recorded in Han Su. So it's written by the Han Chinese. So they would tend to, they would enjoy to write things like that to make themselves stronger. They say, oh, the enemy is so weak, that's why they have to submit to us. But is that the true story? You would never know, because we don't have records from the Xiongnu side. Okay, I believe very strongly that this one has been skipped already. Okay, it's not really that sense. But from the Chinese perspective, they are very proud of this. That, oh wow, the Xiongnu surrendered to us because we are so much stronger than them. It's a issue of face for the Han Chinese. And let's take that aside, that let's consider that yes, the Xiongnu are quite big and they need military assistance. But beside that, what are the perks if you surrender to the Han Chinese? So these are some of the perks. Well, all along they have been raiding for goods, right? Yes, they've been reading for goods from the Chinese Empire. So if I submit to them and you have the tributary system, it's one way, one good way of getting Chinese goods from the Chinese Empire. We don't have to fight anymore to get the Chinese Empire, to get these luxurious goods from the Chinese Empire. So that's a good thing for them. Okay, so they decided to make peace and surrender, so-called, to Chinese Empire so that they can get the things they wanted all along from the Chinese Empire. And one thing to note is that the Xiongnu did not surrender. This is a very special kind of surrender. It's a surrender where it's not because you lost to that country in a war. Usually when you say this country surrendered to another one, it's because that country has been defeated in a war and they have to submit to the aggressor, but this is not the case. This is a unique form of surrender where the Xiongnu surrendered not because of military defeat to the Chinese, but they needed military assistance from the Chinese Empire and to get the goods from the Chinese Empire. So we've been talking about the tribute system all along. So what exactly is this system about? I will cover that in detail. Okay, this tribute system does not just start from the Han Empire. In fact, it has its roots from antiquity. Even as early as the legendary dynasties of Xia and Shang. And what does this theory suggest? So in the Han, for the Chinese people, this is how they see the whole world. Okay, the whole world is under their influence somehow. It's just whether how strong the influence is over that area. So the closer this terrain is to the center power, the more influence and the more control it has over that region. So for the Xiongnu, they will qualify as the outer area. Okay, I have a few areas here. Okay, we have different concentric circles here. So this is the layers of influence. And the commitment needed for each vessel, right, under the different area is also different. So let's say you fall under this area, you need to pay more tribute. You need to come more often. But if you fall under that, the outer area, okay, you can come once every 2 years, it's okay, I understand, because you live very far. Okay. And you don't have to pay too so much. I understand, very difficult to come over to my central court. Yeah. Okay, so this is the kind of theory they have. Okay, so for the barbarians, they will be under the outer area, because they reside far away. Okay, and Chinese take pride that during the legendary days, this kind of tribute system already took place. And during the Qin dynasty, there was this memorial that was submitted to the emperor. And this is evidence that the tributary system has been really in place. And there's a strong belief in maintaining this system. Formerly, in the time of the five legendary emperors, Wudi, that is very early on antiquity times, the royal domain, that means the central area, which they have the most control over, was 1,000 square li. Beyond it were the lords' zone and the barbarians' zone. Some of the lords came to pay homage at the court and some did not. The Son of Heaven had no control over them. So what this says is that the Chinese Empire takes a lot of pride in this tributary system. And whether an emperor is able to make the barbarians come and submit to them and pay tribute is a sign of how strong this emperor is. So if the emperor fails to do so, the barbarians stop paying tribute. That means this is a weak emperor. So for the Chinese Han Emperor, they are very happy. For the very first time, a Xiong Wu Chan Yu actually come to their court to pay homage and pay tribute. So in 51 BC, this is a landmark for them, a milestone. For the first time, the Chan Yu comes to pay respect to the Chinese court. And the officials acknowledge, okay, yes, you belong to the wild zone, not so cultured, not so refined. Yeah, it's okay, so you can come once in a while. Not expected to pay regular homage, just offer tribute once. And we still give you some face and respect since you come all the way here. I will treat you as a ruler, you can sit next to me, you don't sit far away. Okay, treated as a ruler rather than a subject. I think one of the things is the Xiongnu Chan Yu doesn't have to prostrate. I think that's one of the things that he was exempted from. Yeah, okay. So the Chan Yu, other than going to the court, he has to send his son over to be a hostage, to be staying in the Chinese court. And this is quite a big switch for the Xiongnu on their side, because formerly, during the Han Gaozu's time, okay, the Xiongnu was treated as equals. That means we are on par, we are of equal military strength, you don't have to even come and pay tribute. We are allies, we are on equal. But now the Xiongnu has been reduced to a vassal state. It's a big switch for the Xiongnu status. Having said that, it is not to say that the Han Empire had much more control over the Xiongnu now. Not true, because the Xiongnu is still residing so far away. Okay, they would have a bit of influence, but the Xiongnu still remain largely independent. In fact, that is how the tributary system is. Okay, you send somebody, you pay me tribute, I give you something back, it's a sign of respect and submission, but I still allow you to run your kingdom your own way. Okay, there is still largely political rights for this tributary system. And because of this decrease in status for the Xiongnu, now the Han Chinese refuse to marry their princess already to the Xiongnu. So in fact, when the Xiongnu people ask for ladies to be married to them, the Han Empire sent palace in lady in waiting instead. That means attendants, lady attendants over to be married off. One of the person, quite famous personality, would be Wang Zhaojun. She's not a royalty, she's an attendant in the palace. She was married off to the Xiongnu. So it's a happy thing for the princess. Yay, I don't have to be married off to a foreign land anymore. Ah yes, I believe I have mentioned this. The Chan Yu don't have full street. Okay. And there are some assumptions and some things being done so to give him some face, and his status is not as low as the other princes and lords. For example, when he's assigned a place to sit, he sits at a certain position which signifies that he's of a higher position other than the princes and the lords. And as a sign of respect, when he's introduced, he was called by his official title, not by his personal name. And in exchange, actually it's quite a good deal, you see. These are the things you get from the emperor. 5 kg of gold. Wow. 200,000 cash. 77 suits of clothes. I don't know how much that is. 8,000 bales of silken fabrics. 1,500 kg of silk cloth. 680 kiloliters of grain. That's a good deal. So I don't think it's such a bad thing to surrender. Yes?
It's silk cloth. What is that?
It's a raw silk.
Yeah, these are actually the exotic goods from the Chinese Empire. The Chinese is well known for making silk clothes. And you don't have silk in the Xiongnu Empire, and they need to get this from the Han Chinese.
Is it the three state or the vessel, is it the same as a colony?
Colony is a different concept altogether. For colony, it's more of you go over, you occupy the lands, you send people to rule the subjects there, and then you get the resources from there back to your own country. So it's more like an exploitation, but here it's win-win situation for this tributary system.
Actually, yeah, I'm just thinking that, I mean, isn't silk supposed to be the well-kept secret, which is not supposed to be known by
the Yeah, but that's why the gift is not a silk laborers from Han Empire, but the silk raw material itself. So the trade secret is not lost.
I understand Okinawa also has a tributary state from China. Okinawa.
Oh, okay.
Tributary state,
right? That one I'm not sure.
Maybe
that was.
Because I read the internet.
Maybe during the Tang or Ming period. Yeah.
Sorry, yeah. Because for this tributary system, I got a different opinion. May I know which emperor sent Wang Zhao Jun over? Was it before Han Wudi?
That was after Han Wudi, which is this part that I'm covering.
Oh.
After Han Wudi, yes.
Okay, so then the tributary system, in my opinion, actually it started in Han, but actually it's the founder of the Han dynasty. Because the Han emperor himself was caught by the Xiongnu. He was forced to send princess over, send gifts over, and upgrade the status of the Xiongnu from so-called vassal or barbarian to brotherly state. Actually, it's the other way around. The tributary states should start with Xiongnu. They were the one might superior than over the Han. That's why Han Wudi wanted to change this situation, and he also wanted the horse, the Xue Han Bao. That's why he was into the war. So, especially for this Han Su, if I'm not wrong, it was compiled by dynasty after Han.
Mm-hmm.
So whatever they say is more to for their own status,
okay.
Upgrade themselves,
yes,
for
yes,
their own place.
Yes, yeah. Yeah.
So actually, if I'm not wrong, actually started in the other way, it's the other side.
Excuse me. Let me just add on.
Excuse me.
Yeah.
Can we finish the lecture first, leave the Q&A to the end, and then we discuss about it. Rather than in the section, you go, no end of the lecture.
Okay. Okay, since it's coming on that, I will cover a bit on that first before I move on. So the Q&A, maybe we can leave it during the intermission. Okay. I think it's good to give the background context also, because earlier on, for my first part of the talk, I did mention that the Han Empire had a peacemaking policy which is called a Hexin. So the Hexin, we don't see it as a tributary system the other way around, because the Hexin was itself a policy. Yes, it was itself already a policy during the Warring States, where you marry your princesses off to the opponent to make to commit to a kind of military alliance. But there isn't this acknowledgement of you are a vassal state to me, but it is more of we are on par, we are equal, we are allies. I don't control you, you don't control me, it's just that we commit to each other in times of military aid. So that's the main difference. And for a tributary system, it's an acknowledgement that I'm lower than you. I have to submit to you in some way. Okay? So that's the main difference between these two. Okay, I just want to highlight here from the state, from these figures, is that the tributary system is not such a bad idea actually for the Xiongnu, because they are actually in receiving the goods on their end. Every year it is increasing. So if you look at it, the amount for the silk cloth and the silk fabric is going higher and higher and higher. So even though the Han Empire don't have to fight the Xiongnu, but it's very expensive for them to maintain this kind of a relationship. And for the Han, for the Chinese Empire, usually you give me one cake, I give you 10 cake. That's the relationship. I give you more than what I receive. So it is very expensive for them. But the Han Empire is very happy to maintain this relationship because, yes, I'll be spending more, but to them they see this as a more politically superior system that I'm doing rather than fighting with you. So they are very happy to pay the cost even though it is causing a heavy drain on the treasury and more expensive than the marriage alliance which I mentioned earlier on, the Hexin. So is this a true surrender? From the Han Chinese, they see it as a true surrender. Yes, the Xiongnu has submitted to me, but the Xiongnu don't really see it as a true surrender. It's more of a measure they had to take because the situation forced them to do so. They never willingly choose or wanted to submit to the Chinese. If possible, they will reassert their independence and try not to send tributes over to the Chinese. Okay, so the Han Su here says, under the benevolent and compassionate Empress Xuan and Yuan Di, the territories south of the Great Wall belonged to the Son of Heaven, while the land to the north was under the rule of the Chan Yu. If someone crossed the border, he was brought to justice. If someone attempted to defect, his allegiance was not accepted. So this is actually a continuation of the marriage alliance. One of the conditions which I mentioned in my previous talk is that if somebody from my camp wants to go over to your camp and defect, you don't accept him. So this is a good thing out of this relationship with the Xiongnu. So if any Han subjects decide to betray the Han Empire and after a failed attempt of rebellion, they run over to the Xiongnu, the Xiongnu is not supposed to accept them. In terms of true surrender, the Chan Yu don't really surrender in that sense that he had lost his power or authority. You see, he may call himself a Chinese subject symbolically, but he still maintained his rule as an independent ruler. So the treaty mentioned earlier on is that, okay, the north belongs to you, the south belongs to the Chinese. We don't influence each other in our rule. So the surrender comes from the need for the military aid and the political ambitions of the Chan to suppress the rebellion. Okay? And the Han actually had not much influence over the Xiongnu internal affair, even though they accept a hostage prince, but it was more for symbolic reasons. They never really used the hostage prince for any forms of threat. They are quite gentlemen in that sense. So there was no interference over the succession of the Chan Yu. That is to say that for the princes that were sent to the Chinese court, they did not say that, okay, you must be the next Chan Yu to succeed. Okay, the Chan Yu has the decision making in under his own hand whether he wants to make this the next successor, or another eligible prince as the next successor of the Chan Yu. And the Xiongnu still remained in control of the western region. So there was this complaint here by this subject that he doesn't think that the Xiongnu were weakened in any sense in terms of the political rights. In the beginning, when the Xiongnu were powerful, we had no contact with the Wusun or the Kangju. But after their surrender, the Xiongnu did not lose control over these two countries. Even though the Han have received hostages from all of these three peoples, they trade and remain in contact with each other as before. So the holding of the hostage prince did not in any way affect the political decision making of these kingdoms. And this is quite amazing that the peace was maintained for close to 50 years. It's a long period, 50 years. So the Chan Yu continued to send their children as hostages to the Chinese court, and this Chan Yu actually came in person rather than sending other representatives to the court to offer tribute to the Chinese emperor. After receiving all this military assistance and financial aid, the Chan Yu Wu Han Ye became strong. He was able to regain control over the rest of the Xiongnu dissidents, those who go against him. And once again, the Xiongnu was unified briefly under him. Here what we see is that the Chinese were not contented just to keep things as status quo where the Xiongnu had autonomy over their political rights. But the Chinese once in a while would try to exert their influence over the Xiongnu affairs. For example, over here, the Xiongnu attacked the Wusun and captured some hostages. So the Han emperor said to them, "Hey, these Wusun are our friends. How can you just kidnap these people? Return these Wusun hostages back to them." And the Xiong people were very angry. "How can you control and order me over these things? These are things like internal affairs." And the other example of interference is that they forbid the Xiongnu to accept defectors from China, Wusun, Wuhuan, and other Chinese regions of the western regions. And the Xiongnu refused to oblige and refused to give in. So tension was starting to build over these incidents where China tried to slowly, subtly increase their influence over the Xiongnu. And this has come to a point where the Xiongnu could not take it anymore, and they fought and rebelled under the Wang Mang's rule. We are going to go into a break very soon, so just let me conclude the summary of the relation during this period. Then after that, we are going to go into after Wang Mang, what happens. Okay? So the complication is that after maintaining the tributary system, in principle, the system says, "I give you your rights, I have my rights." But in reality, the Chinese wanted to do is, "I want to control you in some way." Okay, but the Xiongnu is strong enough to resist the control because they are not so weak yet at that point of time. And one thing to note is that the surrender and the acceptance of the tributary system was not because the Xiongnu was defeated by the Han Chinese, but more of that there is some form of profit for the Xiongnu. And that's why they agreed to such an arrangement. And if, whenever the tributary system no longer benefits the Xiongnu, they would rise and rebel and break their ties with China. So that explains the on and off relationship between these two civilizations during this period of time. Wu Hanye, there's two. There's one Wu Hanye number one and Wu Hanye number two. So we are talking about number two now. Right, so after the end of the Western Han Empire, there was a usurper by the name of Wang Mang. He's not from the Liu family, but because of his position in the imperial court, he managed to seize power for himself and set up a new dynasty and declare himself as the new emperor. And this dynasty is named as the Xin dynasty, which means new. Okay? It's known as the Xin dynasty by the historians, but it was a very short-lived one. He apparently didn't get support from enough groups of political cliques, so he lost his power very quickly. Just one generation, during the generation of himself, he was later deposed by another Han imperial member, which established another Han dynasty, which historians call the later Han, or the Eastern Han. So from this transition of the Xin dynasty to the Eastern Han, there are some changes in the China-Xiongnu relationship. Okay, what happened was that Wang Mang didn't show as much respect to the Xiongnu, to his predecessors. He tried to exert more influence by even commanding the separation of the Xiongnu tribes. What he did was he ordered that now, from now on, I want the Xiongnu to be divided into 15 parts to weaken them. So you see, because when you have smaller units, it's easier to control lesser army, right, for each faction. And this was clearly a violation of the treaty and tributary system established previously by Wu Hanye and the Xuandi. And the Xiongnu rebelled, they did not want to listen, and for the very first time, a hostage is killed. Okay, Wang Mang executed a Xiongnu hostage in retaliation, and things were very bad between the Chinese and the Xiongnu. And this resulted because of the intervention in domestic politics, which drove Xiongnu to go against the Chinese Empire and declare war. Okay, shortly after, another civil war broke out. At this time, despite that there's a tension between them and the Han Empire, they weren't unified enough. So there was internal civil war again, and this time it's again about who should be in power, who should be the ultimate ruler of the Xiongnu tribe. And Wu Hanye again repeat the same pattern that they have been doing, surrendering to the Han in return for Chinese military support. But this time there's a very big difference. Okay, other than sending tributes over, sending hostage queens over, there's one more condition now. Okay, which are very drastic move, which is now the Xiongnu have to stay within Chinese border. Last time they still can stay in the Mongolian area, their homeland. But now the Chinese forcefully resettle them within the Chinese border. Okay? And those who resettled within the Chinese border now is known as the Southern Xiongnu. And those that were against the Wu Hanye too, who are more aggressive against the Han Empire, these now are known as the Northern Xiongnu. So the Xiongnu divided into two for the very first time. Okay, so this is a very big difference from the previous surrender. The previous surrender, okay, you still can lead your army, you still can rule your people, you still can live at your old place. But now, once you submit to me and you accept yourself as a tributary state, you must stay within my Chinese territory. This is the main difference. And why? Because the Chinese learned from the previous lesson. If they are so far away, it's very hard to control them. Maybe if I settle them within my borders, it will be easier to control them and to stop them from rebellion. So where do they settle them? Of course, they don't settle them right into the heart of the Han Empire, not in the capital, but they settle them along the northern borders, the northern China region, just south of the Yellow River, around this area. Okay, that was the initial settlement, and later on, the Xiongnu was spread out, redistributed into areas of modern Gansu, Ningxia, Shaanxi, which is all around the northern borders. Okay, And this time, the tributes are done quite regularly. Every year, tribute bearers were sent and hostage prince were sent to the Chinese court every year. So it's like a marathon, relay marathon kind of system. This year, this prince go over. Next year, another prince come over, change hands, and then the previous prince go home. Okay, every year they do that. And the imperial gifts become more regularized and more fixed. That's a more fixed system. Yes, even though the Chinese try to control them by resettling them along the northern borders, still there is an issue. Because you must remember that last time there is no email system. Okay, last time if you want to ride a horse from the capital to the northern borders, maybe it will take some time. Okay, so of course communication is not effective. It's not possible to have a very strong control at the northern borders. So the Xiongnu are still quite independent. But the Chinese try to reassert their influence in other ways in terms of spreading their culture to these Xiongnu people, hoping that they will adopt the Chinese culture and become more Han Chinese. But that did not really happen. Okay? And also they give them a lot of decision-making rights. And when the Southern Xiongnu feel like attacking their counterparts, the Northern Xiongnu, they just have to write a message to the emperor, say, oh, I'm going to attack. No need to ask for permission. Just inform Wudi. Okay? Yes. And even though the Han Chinese try to have a person to oversee what the Chanyu is doing, it's not very effective. What the Han government did was they established a very small military surveillance division to go over to that northern border area. Okay, and this person has the title of general in charge of Xiongnu affairs. Xiongnu Zhonglangjun. Okay, he's in charge of about 5,000 troops to supervise the Chanyu. If the Chanyu try to do something funny, these 5,000 troops can be activated. Okay, and he will be following the Chanyu everywhere. Maybe also go toilet, also go. Maybe to the extent. Okay? So you accompany the Chanyu wherever he go. Okay? And then there's another position called the commander in charge of pacification of barbarians. Wow. Very long name. An-Zi-Yuan-Zi. Okay? So his job is to, if the Xiongnu people, if the Xiongnu generals and chieftains quarrel among themselves and cannot resolve, he will come in and help to resolve. Okay? He will resolve any internal Xiongnu disputes. But with this system, there are very minimal Chinese interference in the political events of the Southern Xiongnu. What do I mean by that? Firstly, this Chinese personnel has no right to or power over the Chanyu succession. So Chanyu has still the right to nominate who is his next successor. Why is this very important? Okay, let me elaborate on that. Let's say I am a potential candidate. I'm not supposed to be the next Chanyu, but you come to me and you say, oh, I'm going to give you support. So you know what to do next when you become the Chanyu. Yes, I know what to do. I will help you back. Okay, so if the Chinese do have some form of influence over the successor, he has power over that new Chanyu. Because the new Chanyu owes his political power to the Chinese intervention. And he will do according to his bidding. But that did not happen here. So the Chanyu was also free to appoint his own workers, his own subordinates. And these subordinates, right, they report to the Chanyu, not to the Han Chinese. And this general, right, he, even though he follow the Chanyu everywhere, he doesn't have the right to punish the Chanyu if the Chanyu do something wrong. Okay? He could only, his power only limits him to punish any other Xiongnu rebels, but not the Chanyu. Okay? But because these Chinese officers are so far away in the northern border, sometimes they take matters into their own hands. What they did was, out of the 20 successions, they are not supposed to interfere, but they did. Okay, out of 20 successions, 4 were actually interfered. by these officers. But still, if you look at it relatively, the percentage is low. Okay? And this is actually not because of the central government, not the emperor asked this general to meddle. But in fact, it is this general who meddled in things in their own hands. They did not receive direct orders from the central court. They are acting on their own. Okay? When the Chinese central court knows about this, they will send people to punish those who interfere. So the conclusion is that whatever kind of influence that the central court wants to act on this Sultan Xiongnu, they are not very effective because of the proximity is too far away from the central court for them to effectively control this Sultan Xiongnu, even though the Sultan Xiongnu has resettled within the Chinese borders. Okay. So if we explore further how much of this Sultan Xiongnu has become Chinese subjects in terms of adapting the Chinese culture, we don't see very heavy influence. Okay? Because relatively wise, the Han population in these areas are still smaller. Most of the population here in these areas are still the Xiongnu people. So their culture, they get to regain, to retain their culture. They don't really identify themselves as Han Chinese, even though there might be one or two very rare cases. One of it would be Liu Yuan during the during the Eastern Jin and 16 Kingdoms. He was one of the Xiongnu princes where he studied in Chinese classics and see himself as Chinese. He adopted the Chinese culture. But that, those cases are very rare. So mostly, largely to say, most of these Xiongnu people still see themselves as Xiongnu. And that becomes a big problem. Okay, that becomes a big problem because when it comes to policy making, population integration, that sort of thing, it becomes a hurdle to unite all these different kind of populations that are non-Han. That will spell into big trouble later on, which I will cover towards the end of the talk. This is to share that despite the cultural independence, that they are not very heavily influenced, but in terms of financial-wise, the Chan Yu seems to acknowledge that financially they are relying a lot on the Han Chinese. But again, this is a record from the Chinese record, so it would be skewed to some sense. So the Chan Yu memorial to the Chinese, that means they write a document and they send it to the emperor. Okay, this is what it says. Your servant humbly thinks back on how since his ancestors submitted to the Han, we have been blessed with your support, keeping a sharp watch on the passes and providing strong armies for more than 40 years. Your subjects have been born and reared in Han territory and have depended entirely on the Han for food. Each year, we receive gifts counted in the hundreds of millions of cash. Okay, two things that I get from here. One is one thing that I get is maybe the Chan Yu means it from the bottom of his heart, he's sincere about it. Or maybe it is just a ploy to tell the emperor, oh, I need you so much, don't worry, I will never rebel. Don't need to send a general to follow me to the toilet. Okay? that's the two interpretations I get from here. But what it means, I leave it to you to interpret. Okay, here's an example of the military independence of the Sultan Xiongnu. For several generations, your servants have enjoyed your infinite benevolence. I realize they like to refer themselves as your servants, which will be wish to repay. We therefore order the Wu Huan and the Xianbei to chastise the northern bandits, the northern Xiongnu in our books, whose Chan Yu they have beheaded and whose nation they have defeated. Your servant has discussed the situation of the northern Xiongnu contention over the succession after the death of their Chan Yu with his kings and nobles and with recently surrendered northern Xiongnu generals as well in order to determine what course to follow. Given their state of disorder, we all consider this time to be auspicious for an attack on the northern bandits. So the north may be defeated and the south re-established, unifying the two nations to make one, only one. This is actually quite an impactful letter. Why is that so? Because normally, if you have any military action you want to take as a Chinese subject, you have to go through the proper procedure of writing a memorial to the emperor first, the emperor discuss, the emperor send the document to you, and then you go. Okay, but here, this Sultan Xiongnu is actually given the power to just write a message saying, I am going to gather the Wuhuan and Xianbei people and some of your Han soldiers to attack Sultan Xiongnu, and I'm going to go ahead. No permission asked, okay? Even though it's stated in a very humble manner, but it's not asking for permission, it's just saying, I'm going to do that. Okay, so yes, the Han Emperor actually gives them the right to do so, to take military actions, so long as it benefits the Han government. Okay, and now the Sultan Xiongnu plays a very important role now, and a very different role. Now we can see a very different situation in terms of military action initiated by the Han government. So in the past, when the Han government wants to attack Xiongnu, they order their own people to attack. But now, they are using the Sultan Xiongnu as their main military aggressor. So the Sultan Xiongnu now has taken the role of defending the Han borders. And they are playing the role of a friendly force to help protect the Chinese northern border. When it comes to this, the Chinese Empire are very proud to highlight this in their memorial. There are a few memorials sent to the emperor saying that in the past, we have sent our own people to attack the Xiongnu and any military aggressor, and these poor people have to go and fight. They cannot farm, they are peasants mostly. But now, with this Sultan Xiongnu, because we are so powerful that we make them submit to us, now they are fighting for us. And now our people can be happy as a peasant. They can continue with farming and doing their daily activity. You don't have to activate our own people. We just use the Xiongnu to fight back the Xiongnu. I'll be great. That is the message of the future memorials, okay? Yes. Now, so the Chinese people really see this as an achievement for them. They will put it in their portfolio. And what about the Sultan Xiongnu? Yes, their identity with the Han Empire has changed over time due to this resettlement and this unique arrangement. Yes, in fact, some of these Xiongnu see themselves as very intimate allies. But here, the choice of word is allies. They don't see themselves as subjects at the end of the day. They don't see themselves. They never do. They always try to see themselves as equal, even though the tributary system stated otherwise. But they have always wanted to see themselves as equal. And they are helping the Han Chinese to fight back the Northern Xiongnu because, yeah, all along I've been staying in your place and you give me money, you give me financial support. Yeah, so now we are good friends. So I'm now helping you to fight, but not as a subject. That's how the Xiongnu see this thing. But from the Chinese perspective, is, oh, you people are my subjects. Wow, you listen to my order, you help me fight. Wow, I'm so good. Okay, so this is the different perspective from these two camps. And because of this misunderstanding, there's some conflict between the two of them. The Southern Xiongnu are always very eager to fight the Northern Xiongnu. Why? Because of the fact that this is a way for them to exert influence over the others. And also because of the financial reward. Every time when the Southern Xiongnu manage a successful campaign against the Northern Xiongnu, the Han government will reward them with a huge amount of cash or something. Okay? So they do it out of this kind of benefit system. And so if any Northern Xiongnu were defeated and submit, they will be redeployed to be part of the Southern Xiongnu track. And that means that this Southern Xiongnu is further used as a military tool. So I've been talking about the Southern Xiongnu so far. So what was the condition like for the Northern Xiongnu? Very bad. Things were very bad for them because now the Southern Xiongnu has the Han Empire as their ally, and they are always getting attacked by different tribes. They are actually attacked by the Han soldiers, the Southern Xiongnu tribes, the Wuhuan, the Wusun. So they are being ambushed from all directions. Very things are very bad for them. Okay, even though they managed to reside in their homeland, but they are being attacked all over. There were instances where you see that the Northern Xiongnu exert the influence, like capturing the western regions, but this kind of power control was only for the short term. Very quickly, they would just lose those territories that they managed to control. And for the Northern Xiongnu, what they would do is that they follow what their ancestors do. They alternate between war and peace with the Han Chinese. And when it comes to the relationship between the Chinese, when they do go for peace, it is more for the sake of trading so that they can get goods to reinforce and supplement their financial sustenance. Okay, and for example, here in this case, when they launched an attack on China, it was more to force the Han people to open up markets for trading, not for territorial gains. So you can see that it still goes back to goods, getting goods. So the Northern and Southern Xiongnu was never unified, thanks to the clever move by the Chinese people resettling the Southern Xiongnu in their borders. Okay? And the intensity of attack on the Northern Xiongnu grew over time. Eventually, the Northern Xiongnu disappeared. Okay? They retreated to the west, and we do not really know what happened. There's a lot of rumors. Some people say that they went to Hungary and became Hungarians. Okay? That's one theory. Okay, but we will never know. Most likely, I think that they were so weakened that they intermarried with the tribes that they met along the way, and they lose their culture. That's what happened to the Northern Xiongnu. And when the Northern Xiongnu disappeared, who replaced them in the Mongolian steppes? They were replaced by another new tribe, the Ruanran, the Yada. So these are the new tribes that came in to replace the vacuum created by the Northern Xiongnu. Now, because even though the Northern Xiongnu disappeared, and it signaled an opportunity for the Southern Xiongnu to go and recapture back their homelands, but they have been resettled in the Chinese borders for so long that they already grow attached to the Chinese, to this Chinese land. And it became very difficult for them to go back to re-establish the control of the Mongolian steppes. I don't think I want to go into a lot of details of this. This is just to share with you that over time, I did mention that the Chinese government tried to influence more, exert more control over the Xiongnu political matters. So this is one incident of a direct intervention of deciding who to be the next successor. And what is different about this one is directly controlled by the central government. It's not from the general that is residing at the border. Okay, so this is just some instances of how the Chinese Central Court tried to influence Xiongnu political matters. But relatively speaking, still very little, very minimal of such cases. And how loyal is the Southern Xiongnu to the Chinese Empire? As I say, they never see themselves as Chinese subjects, but more as equals and very close, intimate allies. So whenever there is a move from the Chinese government to we establish control over them, then they will try to break free and launch military attacks to give warnings to the central government that I am still capable of wrecking your government if you try to do anything funny and intervene in our matters. So these are examples of uprisings, and these uprisings, when we interpret and analyze them, we see that these uprisings are not done in any way to gain territory from the Xiong people, but it is more of to give warnings to the Chinese government that I am still capable, my military is still strong and capable of toppling your government. So if you try to control me, this is the fight back that I will give to you. Okay, we will fight back to regain our control. Then there was a rebellion in AD 109. So this was one example of how the Southern Xiongnu would sometimes lead a rebellions because they see the Chinese government being a threat to their political power. So they will rise in arms. But usually these rebellions end very quickly. Yes, Cao Cao. Okay, so the Xiongnu after the later Han. So, you know, in terms of the historical timeline, you have Western Han, Xin Dynasty, and then later Han, Eastern Han, and then you have your three kingdoms, right? Yeah, so let's look further down and see what happens after the fall of the later Han. And when it comes to the later Han period, the Southern Xiongnu, they themselves have an internal quarrels, and there was a civil war that resulted. So the Southern Xiongnu became weakened. At the same time, the Han Empire was also weakened. You have the rise of various different warlords, and Cao Cao was one of the warlords that controlled the north. So the north, as you remember, the northern borders is the area where these Xiongnu, Southern Xiongnu people reside. So Cao Cao had the power to control this Xiongnu, and not at this time the Xiongnu had not enough military power anymore to support their own independence, and Cao Cao could easily divide the Xiongnu into five administrative groups under his control. And Cao Cao and other warlords would capitalize on that and use the Southern Xiongnu as their military force, mainly in the cavalry. And during the Three Kingdoms, you would see that quite a substantial amount of the army is actually made up of non-Chinese soldiers. So the Xiongnu is one of the main source of army for them. So the Xiongnu is just one. There's also the Wuhuan and the Wusun as well. And these people make up very good cavalry force because of their because of how they are brought up. They used to live in the steppe desert. So the Xiongnu became weakened and remained under Chinese influence during the Three Kingdoms period. So the main source of troops, especially cavalry troops, were non-Han soldiers. And these non-Han soldiers were used not just for foreign campaigns, but also to suppress Chinese internal rebellions as well. So now this Xiongnu tribesmen made up a big number, an important force in the Han soldiers. And what happened to this Xiongnu after the Three Kingdoms? That is what these talks are what I covered earlier on when I was covering the Northern and Southern dynasties. The central government weakened. There was fights between the Jin princes, and this created an opportunity for those who hold on military force to come to rise. Now you see, usually the Xiongnu, they were given military powers. They were usually given the power to control and command soldiers And so these generals make use of the opportunity to rise to power and set up their own kingdoms. And in the Northern and Southern Dynasty period, you see that the northern part of China was ruled by these non-Chinese people. And this problem resulted because of Chinese policies, where they resettled the Southern Xiongnu in their own Chinese border. Not just the Xiongnu, but the other non-Han tribes. And that gave rise to the problem of losing the control of northern China to these people. We have come to the last part already, so we're going to sum up everything and analyze what are the pros and cons of this policy of resettling the non-Han ethnic tribes into the Chinese border. Okay, so for the Chinese, if they don't really want to exterminate the Xiongnu because they knew that it was not possible. So they decided that a better way would be to use these non-Chinese tribesmen to go against each other. And that resulted in the division of the Northern and Southern Xiongnu. By resettling these people within the Chinese terrain, there was also a move initiated by the Chinese government to try to convert these people to becoming more Chinese-like. What do I mean by that was that, remember that there are hostage princes being sent to the central court, and these usually are the possible successors to the Han Yu. So when they are sent as hostages to the imperial court, they are given Chinese education. Okay, they are given lessons on Confucian texts, Chinese tradition, rites and rituals in the hope of converting these princes into more Chinese-like. So when they go back, right, to rule their tribes, they might spread this influence of the culture to their tribesmen, and in this way they convert them into Chinese, into identifying with the Chinese identity. That is to say that even though they are not born as Han Chinese, but so long as you affiliate yourself with the culture, you are seen as a Han Chinese. Okay, that was one of the things that Han Chinese were working towards too, because they do see themselves as culturally more superior. And when they expose their culture to the barbarians like the Xiongnu, they will be so awed and impressed that they will submit and take up this culture willingly. So that was the mentality from the Han Chinese. But that actually did not really happen. You see, the Chinese don't really see themselves as Chinese subjects, and most of them did not convert themselves to see themselves as Chinese. There's a very big risk in resettling this Xiongnu people in the Chinese terrain. I would see it as a move with short-term benefit, where you tackle the immediate problem of Xiongnu incursions into China, but it gives rise to long-term issues. Okay, what do I mean by that? This is a memorial, okay, being submitted to the emperor. Since the rise of the Han, there have been repeated offensive expeditions, but their gains never match their losses. Guang Wu, which is the Eastern Han founder, having experienced the trials of warfare, understood the order of heaven and earth. So, following the nomads coming to surrender, he nourished them under a Lu's reign. The people at the frontier were able to live, and their service was halted. Up to today, it has been more than 40 years. Now the Xianbei are obedient and capture heads of Xiongnu number in tens of thousands. China enjoys this great achievement, and the common people know nothing of its toil. In this, the Han has reached its apogee, and the reason it is so is because the barbarians attack one another with no loss to the Han armies. This is a short-term gain to me. in resolving the issue of non-Chinese invasions at the northern border. It's a very clever move, I agree, that you make use of one barbarian to fight another barbarian without having any loss with your direct, with your immediate Han population. It's a clever move, but it has given rise to serious implications later on. So what is the serious issue? You see, the Southern Xiongnu existence, very existence is meant to curb Northern Xiongnu. So with the Northern Xiongnu gone, or with any other potential threat from the steppes gone, what is the job of the Southern Xiongnu? What do? They got no job. Retrench them. Hire them in civil sector. Not possible, right? Because that is how they are brought up. So yes, it has very good short-term benefits, but long-term-wise, they haven't thought long enough. That was the problem. They haven't thought long enough. So what will happen? What are we going to do next to this Southern Xiongnu force once the Northern Xiongnu is gone? You see, the very pay, the very basis of their pay is dependent on how many people they kill, okay, out of the Northern Xiongnu. So if the Northern Xiongnu is gone already, they have no more bonus. No more bonus really for their military service. So how, when do they attack? They turn backwards and raid China now for income. Okay, and then you have the rising population. So these nomads are growing and growing and growing. It's very hard to control them. Now the very main problem is that the Chinese tried very hard to convert them to being Han Chinese by subjecting them to Chinese culture, but that did not work. So that resulted in the fact that these troops are not loyal. They don't see themselves as part of the Chinese cultural sphere. And there was racism ongoing. Yes, there was the Xiongnu and the non-Han people were being despised upon. There were also incidents where these people were exploited to become slaves. So they feel that they are very unfair. It's where things are very unfair to them and they are being mistreated. This gives rise to the building up of anger. Okay, and this satisfaction towards the Chinese government. And when the opportunity rises, they came up to arms and go against China. So this is the problem of resettling these people inside China. Okay, so conclusion, even though the Chinese tried to, the Xiongnu did not lose their ethnic identity despite the surrender and resettling within Chinese Empire. The marriage of the Han princess was no longer seen as a hostage move, but a sign of a keeping relationship with the Han imperial family. The Han Chinese viewed the Xiongnu former surrender as an acknowledgement of submission to the Chinese, but that was just the Chinese perspective. It was not so in the case where the Xiongnu never see themselves as Chinese subjects. That's the end of the talk.